Hi students, several of you have asked me to please record through theme 5C Gantt charts and resource loading, although I did send you the slides while I was in hospital. So here goes. The why does this not want to? Okay. So the outcomes of this lecture is that at the end you must be able to develop a project schedule. And you must be able to determine the resource loading for resources on a project. And in your assignment that you're busy working on, you have to do it for at least one project resource. Okay, so the Gantt chart was developed in the 1910s by a guy called Henry Lawrence Gantt. And it was employed on major infrastructure projects, including the Hoover Dam and the interstate highway in the United States. The reason Gantt developed this tool was because they wanted a simple, common scheduling tool that was easy to understand, and we use this tool to this day. So it's been used for over 104 years. So it shows you that the tool is actually an old and tried and trusted tool, and the fact that we haven't come up with major innovations in the last 100 years must say something about the fact that the tool is working. Okay, so when we develop a Gantt chart, we obviously start with our activity precedence and duration table. Now, the activity precedence and duration table is also used, as you know, to draw up your network diagram. Now, the Gantt chart is just a visual representation of the schedule of your project. The Gantt chart in and of itself cannot be used to calculate the critical path of your project and to calculate when activities become critical, etc., etc. That is what we use a network diagram for. So when you use software like Microsoft Project that basically works on the basis of doing a Gantt chart for you, Microsoft Project uses the calculations and the formulas that we teach you on doing a network diagram to actually calculate the critical path for you. So the underlying software that is implemented in Microsoft Project is that of the network diagram. So having said that, if we take this activity precedence and duration table, and what I want you to do at this stage is to stop the video and then draw the network diagram and calculate the forwards and backwards path and critical path for this specific project, for the project that's shown in this activity precedence and duration table. Then once you've done that, you can start the video again. Okay, so I hope that you all have come to the same conclusion that I have, that this is the network diagram for the activity precedence and duration table given over here. So you will see that the critical path is A, B, C, F, and activities D and E are not on the critical path. And remember, if you want all the marks in the test or the exam, you have to give the key for the network diagram. Okay, so let's then talk about how do we generate the Gantt chart. So the first step of the Gantt chart is to realize that we want to put time on the x-axis and the activities on the y-axis. This is the convention that was developed by Mr. Gantt in 1910, and it is the convention that we still use today. Now, for these slides, I used Excel to generate the graphics. And unfortunately, with Excel, I can't make the zero appear on the line as it is shown over here, so above the line. But so basically, the zero that's next to the line implies that the zero is above the line, or the line is above the line, as over here. Okay, so in other words, when we say that the activity starts at zero, we mean that it starts on the zero line. I think step two of the Gantt chart is we first find all the activities that have no predecessors. So in our example over here, A is the activity that has no predecessor. So A will then start at zero, and A continues for one day, and it ends then at day one. A is then also the predecessor of B and the predecessor of D. So that means we can go, or rather B and D can start once A is completed. So that means that B and D can start on the line for day one, and B continues for 2 days, so that's 1, 2 days, and D continues for 1 day. Okay. Now, the other thing with the Gantt chart is that we must also include, we must show precedence on the Gantt chart, and this is normally done by the dotted line. So the dotted line over here tells me that activity A and B are connected in the sense that activity A must be completed before activity B can start. Okay, so if I have a precedence line like this, if activity A moves out and is, say, delayed up until 2, that means that the dotted line will have to move up until 2, and B will also then be delayed by the day that A has been delayed. Okay, so step 5 of this Gantt chart is then to look at activity B and see which for which activities B is the predecessor. In this case, B is the predecessor for C, so C can start when B is completed. So C can start at day 3, and C continues for 3 days, so 1, 2, 3, and ends then at day 6. Then D is the predecessor of E, so E can start once D finishes at day 2, and E continues for 2 days, so E continues for 1, 2, so it continues up until day 4. Right, so now we only have one activity left, which is F, and as you can see from the precedence diagram, C and E are predecessors for F, so you can see C and E are predecessors for F. So you can see that there is 2 days float here for E, but we still have to indicate that E is the predecessor for F by putting the dotted lines on. So you can see now that the project manager has some freedom when they decide or to decide when E must start, because they could use the float over here, but the downside of making E start at 4 and end at 6 is that if something then goes wrong on E, E then starts impacting on the critical path. So those decisions one has to take very carefully. Alright, now stop the video at this stage, and you will see that there is a Gantt chart assessment on my tutor. So there is a Gantt chart there that you can do, and it asks you questions, and the answers to the questions are also given. Okay, so welcome back. So when we display information on a Gantt chart, one of the strengths of a Gantt chart is that we can vary the level of detail to which we display the information. So say, for example, we are busy laying a foundation. Our top management is interested in the rolled-up information. So they just want to know that the foundation will start on the 20th of May and it will be completed by the 20th of July. They're not interested in the detailed activities, whereas the project manager would want to know when excavation will start and finish, when footings will start and finish, when the basement walls will be installed and finished, etc., etc. And then the site manager will use an even higher level of detail, because the site manager will, for example, break down the task of doing the footings even further into forms, reinforce, strip, etc., etc. And so that's why tools like Microsoft Project give you the ability to show information at the various levels. If you set it up in such a way that various levels are identified, you can roll up the levels, and when you are then talking to top management, you only give them the level of detail that they are interested in. Okay, so Gantt chart pros and cons. One of the advantages of the Gantt chart is that it's easy to construct and understand. If you give somebody a chart that looks like this, and you give them a basic explanation, they should be able to understand that, for example, activity D starts at day one and ends at day eight. The problem with the Gantt chart is, if we look at it like this, what now happens if C starts 2 weeks late? So in other words, if we take C and we move it on for 2 weeks, okay, if we look at it, we can see that because it has floats, there probably is no effect, but what happens if C is 6 weeks late? Okay, now it becomes a little bit more complicated to try and understand what activities must move on and what is the impact down the line. And that's why we never forget about the network diagram, because obviously the calculations that we do on the network diagram will give us these answers. Okay, so the same if E takes 3 weeks instead of 2 weeks, or if what happens if E finishes a week early? What is the effect down the line? Do we actually save anything? Because are we actually saving on the critical path, or is E not on the critical path, so it doesn't really matter whether we finish it early or not? Okay, so with a simple Gantt chart, the questions that we've just discussed are not always easy to answer, yet you need to answer to plan the project and to create realistic schedules. So Gantt charts are good for displaying schedules, but networks are better for creating them. So so when you create the schedule, you use a network, and then also when you do what-if analysis, where you look at what if this happens or that happens, the underlying logic that you need to use is the logic of the network diagram. Okay, so that basically then handles the topic of the Gantt chart. So in this topic, you need to know how to take the precedence and duration table and then generate a Gantt chart from it. Okay, so the next topic that we want to cover is resource loading. So why do we want to determine resource loading? We now know how long the project will take and what the critical path is, but what if one resource is working on more than one activity which is in parallel? What is the effect on the duration of our project? And this is where resource loading comes into it. So if we take our activity precedence and duration table that we had previously with resources, excuse me, but just take note that on this slide over here, E in this column should be D. Okay, so just imagine that you see a D over here. I'll change it on the slides that I put up on the system. Okay, so now we not only know the activities and the predecessors and their duration, we also know who the resources are that are going to be working on those activities. So the first thing we can now do is we can draw the Gantt chart showing the resources for each activity. And we then draw the resource loading diagram under this Gantt chart. We put time on the x-axis, and we put efforts in terms of number of hours on the y-axis. So a line that runs on the Gantt chart from 0 to 1 means that a person has to work 1 day, And in project management, we normally say one day is equal to 8 hours. So that is the rule of thumb. In various industries, you might work different lengths of days of different lengths, but the project management software is normally quite forgiving in terms of that, and you can only set up how you see a day and how you set up a day for your environment. Okay, so here is now our Gantt chart with resources. You can see here D is correct. Okay, and when we look at our Gantt chart with resources, you can see that poor Sue is going to have a hard time on this project because Sue is working on activity B and activity D. And while activity B is still busy, Sue is also supposed to start activity E. Alright, so let's now look at how do we determine the resource loading for Sue. So as you can see, what we do is we draw our Gantt chart with resources, and right underneath it, we draw our our resource loading diagram. So what I suggest in the exam, take your exam script and turn it sideways and then draw your Gantt chart and use the lines that are in the exam script as your lines that you will be using to show the time, and then you draw your Gantt chart using those lines. Okay, and you put your activities. And if we then look at Sue, imagine that we have a red little rectangle. So this red dotted rectangle is how we are looking at each period that Sue has to work. So for day 0 to 1, you can see that Thabo is working on activity A and Sue is not working at all. So that means that we then draw her resource loading as 0. So she works from 0 to 1, she works at 0. So the line here at the bottom is the 0 line. Okay, so then if we go on to day 1 to 2 and we move our rectangle on one day, you will see that Sue works on activity B and Sue works on activity D. So that means 16 hours, because 8 plus 8 is 16 hours. So now we draw the resource loading of Sue and we indicate that she now, her resource loading for period 1 to 2 goes up to 16 hours. Then we move our rectangle to day 2 to 3. And Sue is still at 16 hours because she works on activity B and she works on activity E. So that's 16 hours. Then if we move our rectangle on to the next period, you will see that Sue only works on activity C. So now her resource loading comes down to 8 hours. Then period 4 to 5. Sue does not do any work because Thabo is now the one doing the work and on activity C. So her loading is 0. The same goes for period 5 to 6. And then if we look at 6 to 7, Sue is now again working on activity F. So she has one activity, which is 8 hours. So we indicate her resource loading as 8. Sorry, I see there's a mistake in the slide here because that and that does not correspond. I'll change it for the slides that I upload. Okay, then for days 7 to 8, Sue is working 8 hours because she's working on activity F. And the same thing happens for day 8 to 9, she's still working on activity F, so that's 8 hours. And voila, that basically is what the resource loading for Sue is looking like. So this means that from days 1 to 3, Sue is overloaded, as she has to work 16 hours a day. So So normally when you draw the resource loading and you get a situation like this, this is where you as the project manager now has to take certain decisions, and you can either do resource leveling, you can add extra resources, but most things that you do will impact either on the time or on the cost of the project. But exactly what we do and how we do that is out the scope of this part of the course. And next semester, when we talk about a critical chain, we will talk about this in a little bit more detail. Okay, so stop the video and do the resource learning assessment on my tutor for this theme. You see there's an assessment with questions and final answer. And that basically is the end of theme 5C. Good luck with your preparation for the test. I hope it all goes well and that you all do well in the test.